Last year we have done an huge project for us. For us it's Monique Devanchant and me, myself, Jeroen Bakker. It's the OpenCL compositor and the compositor redesign. Last year during the conference we did an OpenCL test, and basically the outcome of the OpenCL test is from, well, it works, but we need to do a lot of things inside the kernel of Blender in order to get it real stable. And last year that project was being creating that stable kernel in order to for OpenCL to get working in the compositor. Documentation can be found, and well, let's see. This is the compositor. As I opened the compositor, you saw that it was building up in tiles. This is mainly because of the memory issues you have when you're using OpenCL. I can load the render buffers, and you see that the image is displayed. This is the final composite. You can change settings, and you will see the composite directly interacts and changes. You can change the colors, and you see it interactively changes. Every pixel that has been calculated is displayed on screen. If you go to the viewer node, if I select the viewer node, you will see a very big cross. This cross represents the pixel that will be first calculated. You can change that if you like, because it could be that you are working on the nose. And, or to the tie. Changing this will start calculating there. But you can also say from, well, I'm not really into a specific part, only random tiles of a composite. You can change and it will get there. Oops, okay. This image is not that large, it's a 1K image. And you see it directly changes. Okay, let's open the next one. The next one I want to show is an Cintel image, and I will do some stuff with it. Home, Venom, Apps. This is a Cintel image, and on the backdrop you will see it. So, one part that's very difficult in Blender is to change the color settings. Well, we now have a color correction node. It's a very huge node, but you can connect it and change things you like. You can change the saturations of the whole image, and it's directly added. But you can also say, well, I only want to change the saturations of the darker colors. And it will be applied. You can change the settings of the darker colors. But to be very useful, it would be nice to have some masking. We can use some masking. I added the mask node, and you'll directly see a square is added to that to the background. The square you can move around. And you can change the size of it. And then you can apply that mask to a node. And you will see that directly only the effect will happen to that part of the image. But to create a more complex mask, you can bind masks. Like I also have a box mask I added to it. And that box mask I rotate a bit. I'm sorry? Yeah. Yes, we can also subtract those masks. Then the square mask is subtracted from the ellipse. But it's only useful for simple masking. But to be, this mask, it has very strong lines. You can also use a blur to make that line we can delete or erode that mask. And when we do it, we now have several options more. We can change the distance of that erosion, but also the inset. How much pixels are used to make less steep lines. Yes. Okay.
Can you use an alpha image of another mask of your own choice?
No, you can use everything as a mask. It's not limited to these nodes. It's just these nodes can simplify some tasks. Yes. Black and white image, just the same as you create masks. The system itself converts it as the node wants it, so you don't have to worry about that. And other things that some people worry about is the resizing of images. Like I have this image. I want to mix that one with another image. And that image is a file. I open the file. Logo.png. And I mix those two together. What we'll see is that the logo itself is not fully, it's in the center of the last image. But sometimes this is not good enough. You want to fill it the whole image. If you change the render size, that the image size also changes. Currently with the user interface, it's not possible, but in the framework, it is already there. And with some Python, you can access that part. I will go to my mix node. It's called mix. I go to my inputs. I select the second input, that's the second image. And I look at the resize mode. If I see, it's center. And I can set it to fit width. And then Blender crashes. It's still experimental, but you know, on this system, I just tested it to today, but perhaps it's a known bug or an unknown. Let's try it again. I render the cube. And the image is there. I can change the alpha again, try it again. If it fails, I continue with the next context. Dot scene dot node tree dot nodes. Nodes inputs. Major typo. And you will see that the image fits to the width. If I change the resolution and I render the image again, it will stick to the width of the rendered image. Next one. Basically, you see that the system builds up, but it's the you get faster feedback of what's going to on what will the final image look like. This makes the workflow of the compositor much more interactive, and the you will get more speed. That's at least what we want. But that speed can also be used to make more complex nodes. Oops. I will do a a different node setup, I will get an image of London, London Bridge, not London Bridge, but another one. And you will see London Bridge. This is a 2K image. And now I can try to do a real bokeh blur on it.
No,
no, I disabled it. And you'll see that the bokeh is rendered, and the bokeh is a square. And you see that it's not real time. It's just it's not real time. But you can also change the settings. We can say I'm editing right now. I don't need the final quality of the image, and I change it, and it looks almost the same. You will get the quality, but it's much faster, as you'll see. This calculation takes normally 4 times more than the other one I did. But having a real bokeh blur has some advantages. You can change how the camera look in the internals of the camera look like, and you can apply it. You can change the angle of the bokeh image, and it rotates. But also, the rounding of the bokeh image of the camera internals. The defocus nodes we have in Blender, it only has straight lens flaps. We can now have round lens flaps. But also, lenses, the internal part of the lenses, can shift colors. Well, we can also shift colors. And it is affected to the final result. To have more degree of freedom, you can also add a custom bokeh blur image to it. So it doesn't have to be that one. We can add hearts to it.
Much better.
Much better, yes. I did it with Blender. Image editor, I'm not that good at it. but also, I have another input image of a city view of Bangkok. And you will, this is really demonstrating the power of a real bokeh blur image, if I don't exaggerate that much. So, I have some other examples. I have a Sintel file, and it's one of the files that's, well, not secret, but it's not that visible. It's the file that creates the lens flare in the temple scene. As people might know that it uses a really large node setup of a lot of different render layers. but it also uses a blur node that's quite, here it is. It's a Gaussian blur which uses 65% on the x-axis and 84% on the y-axis. It uses a lot of information in order to get it calculated. It's finished.
It's done.
It's finished, yes. It's done.
Maybe you have to compare it with a normal one. Or does it take like 5 minutes?
This one? I'm not sure, but on my system it took a very long time. I can try to find Blender. This one?
No, like I said, the key, the shortcut, Windows, W.
Okay, thank you. I will go to home, Venom, apps, OpenCL, the FLIR rig. Rendering is done in no time, but compositing takes a very long time. It's working. It's doing something.
It's busy. At least you can watch the progress. But in your system, the progress goes too fast.
I'm sorry.
Progress
anymore. Yeah. Yes, yes, yes.
Okay.
I think that the project is going well, I would say. Haven't seen any results yet. Yes. It's here right now.
This is going to
take a while. Yes. And basically, this is all done only using the CPU. The framework is ready for the OpenCL, and we are currently in the testing phase to implement Nodus on the OpenCL version. But everything you saw to today, it was on the CPU. I'm sorry?
So it's right now it's still actually a lot slower than it will be?
Yes.
A lot.
I did in the beginning of this year did a test using the Fermi chip of NVIDIA, and I did a bokeh blur creating a full image into a single color by using extreme settings. And it took 34 seconds in order to do a 2K image. And on the normal CPU, it would, I'm not sure, hours perhaps. So, yeah.
What kind of things happen?
No.
I think
I'm not sure this is the old one. Let's go back to the system. Here we can zoom out. We also have some as the whole system is determines its output on based on the pixel user wants to see, we can also do some tricks. Like what I did here was to have a node called the switch node. The switch node, if the current frame number is less than 50, it will take the input image of that part of the tree. On the and does not calculate the other part. If it is 50 or above, it will use the other one. So if you have an effect that doesn't display at a certain range of frames, you can bypass that whole subsection of the tree. It is also possible to do. We really have to see how the final nodes will look like. I'm thinking about a checkbox or a drop down list, what you can animate. That would be much better than having a start frame or an end frame. Well, let's have the cube. I'm always starting with the cube. If I composite this cube and I use a blur in it, let's start use this one. You will see that only the cube part is calculated, but every pixels here outside in the gray area is also calculated. You can use you can set a bounding box on the area where that effect has to be calculated, and then you will see that only that part is calculating inside this node, and everything is passed through, and that takes no performance at all. Oops. Well, this is the end of the presentation. Are there any questions? Oh, let's start here.
And I see that you use lots of numeric controls in it. Is it possible, or do you have any plans for making this, for example, the obstacles interactive in
That are the ideas to have handles, but there wasn't the discussion about it if it should fit in the image editor or in the backdrop of the notes editor. But it can be done. It's not that much of work, but I didn't take any attention to it yet. So,
You have a number of controls there that allow you to center where you want the calculation to start from, right?
Yeah.
But you also have the Raman version, which basically makes so that you get a general overview of everything.
Mm-hmm.
I saw a numeric dial somewhere, and I wonder if it was called second size or something like that. Just basically, can you actually make the second size or chunk size? That's it. Is that the control for making the chunks smaller so that you
can
more fine-grained?
Yes. Yes, we can change that settings, and then it will use it's an fine-tune setting. It will larger chunks will be calculated faster than more smaller chunks, but larger chunk uses more memory, so it's a trade-off. And this is more for fine tuning and knowing the system, Currently, I'm using the chunk size default of 128, but it could be every value you like. So if I delete. If I use an HSV, then you will see the difference. Then I need to have. You will see the size of the tiles, and we can change it. But you will see that it will be slower.
Make it 8.
16 is the less. Less.
Yeah.
Every tile is calculated for by itself, and it could be dependent on a much other size. So you're making the problem much bigger, and that's why it's slower. If you use a larger one, it's finished in no time. If it is finished at all. You see that the outer tiles are calculating much faster than the inner tiles, because only the inner tiles the bokeh blur applies to. The outer side doesn't have any effect.
One last question.
Yes. In the start of the project, color management, that's a very important part of a compositor. We implemented the open color I/O library. During Blender Day, I showed it. But after Blender Day, there was a decision made that the open color I/O problems should be part of the image loading and saving. So it was on technical level, we still need it, and we still need to get it. But another developer is working on it during image loading and saving.
It's I/O input.
Yeah.
We have to.
Well, the big question, when?
When is it finished?
Stop teasing. I can tease a lot more. we are finished for, we have three phases. First phase is finished. That's the CPU implementation. Second phase, the OpenCL implementation. We are testing it. Coding has been done. Third phase is that all the nodes needs to be re-implemented into the new compositor. That takes time, and that part hasn't been planned yet. So afterwards, you will get it.
Everybody here can help porting over the nodes, but that's easy. We have like 30, 40 nodes, so everybody gets one, and then take 2 weeks, and then we have finished.
Yeah.
So let's say November 20th. What's sure. Yes. I will keep track of it, but not in 1 or 2 months, but probably 4 hours.
I think that phase two is the only part that we're doing, and the phase afterwards should be a community project.
So depends on the
yes.
Next one. Oh, Don't walk away, it's not possible.